here. In today's video, we are going to talk about money and how much UX designers make. But before we get into it, I want to mention that this video was sponsored by Skillshare. I've been using Skillshare very regularly during this quarantine to keep myself inspired and motivated by learning new skills such as acrylic painting, drawing illustrations on my iPad, and learning how to create my own merch. I've been taking these classes as a form of self-care, and I know that a lot of us right now are working hard to build a better future, and that takes a lot of energy. And so taking these fun classes have been very therapeutic, and it's a way for me to recharge, so I hope you can take advantage of that as well. There's also a handful of UX design classes on Skillshare that I know some of you might be interested in. It's a very affordable way to learn something new. It's less than $10 a month for their annual subscription. More recently, I've been enjoying Yasmin Cheyenne's Writing for Self-Discovery class, where I've been able to navigate my complex emotions and thoughts through writing. It is a crazy and dark time that we're living in, and her class has helped me to be kinder to myself and become more aware of how difficult things have been recently in my own life. There's another class I want to recommend. It's Brooke Glazer's Intro to Procreate Illustrating on the iPad. I know some of you have asked me about good iPad drawing classes for beginners. I would say this is a great class to start off with. Another thing that I love about Skillshare is that they're always launching new classes by artists and illustrators that I love following on Instagram. And so taking their classes on Skillshare is one way that I show them support. So the first 1,000 of my subscribers that click on the link down below will get a 2-month free trial of their premium membership. So check that out if you want to pick up something new and fun during this quarantine. Now let's get to the real meaty stuff. The real reason you clicked on this video. You want to know how much I make and how much UX designers make in this field. Now I debated for a long time whether or not to share my salary information so publicly, because it is very personal. It is something pretty private for most people, and I don't know who's going to judge me. I realize that whatever you put out there online, it is going to be open for judgment, and some people might think I'm bragging and just dismiss the whole point of this video. But I felt like it was right for me to talk about something as important as salary. I benefited a lot from other people sharing their salary information. I really believe that knowledge is power, and the more you know, you are better equipped to make decisions for yourself. I've seen so many women and people of color getting the shorter end of the stick or getting lowballed because they're afraid to ask what they deserve, and they don't ask what they deserve because they don't know what they deserve. It's kind of like dating. You don't know what you deserve, and so you end up with a toxic partner. It's kind of the same thing. This was my story too, where I just didn't know what was a reasonable expectation to have until I started asking people what they were making. I started asking other UX designers that were not in my company how much they were making, and I had establish a better sense of what I could expect as an entry-level designer or mid-level designer. So I'm here to tell you my salary journey and my progression so that you have a better sense of what you can expect when you're getting your UX design offers. So right out of college, I was making $42K at my marketing role. Then when I went into UX design and got my first full-time UX design position, I was making about 70 to 85K base salary, and then my second year I was making about 100 to 120K, and then my third year I am now making over 200K in my total compensation package. So what that means is total compensation includes your base salary, your equity, so your stock options, bonuses, and benefits. By the way, all of this is public information. If you go to levels.fyi.com, they do a really good job of breaking down salary information based on levels. So if you're an L3, you're an entry level, L4 and 5 are usually mid levels, and then beyond that are senior levels. You can also search salaries by roles. So if you're a software engineer, data scientist, product managers, you can have all that information as well. I find levels.fyi to be the most accurate when it comes to giving you a rough estimate of what you can expect from these bigger companies like Google, Facebook. I also really like how they give you the years of experience this person who submitted their own compensation has been at for the company and also the years of experience they have overall, because that gives you a sense of their seniority and how much they've been in the field to be making a good amount of money. So I'm going to talk more in depth about my salary progression. So I mentioned that right after college, I was making 42K at my marketing role. I wasn't getting any benefits. I wasn't getting 401k matching. I didn't have any bonuses. So I was barely surviving living in San Francisco with 42K as my salary. So I was actually working tutoring gigs during weeknights and weekends because I didn't have any disposable income and I still wanted to pursue my YouTube channel and make reviews, product reviews, and write blogs, which all cost money. So I had to work side gigs in order to pursue my hobbies. And then when I got my first full-time UX job, I was offered 70K. And then I negotiated up to 75K, but I knew that I could go up to 80 or 90K because I had friends who were in a similar boat as me who just finished boot camp and they were getting higher offers. But then there was a trade-off. They were getting offers from startups where they had to do all of the designs, whereas the company that I worked for, they had a design team and I had a manager, and I knew that that was something I really needed early on in my career. So I didn't really mind that I couldn't get a higher base salary than I was getting. The best leverage you can have when you want a higher salary or higher compensation package is if you have another offer on the table that is giving you more money than this other company. So if I had spent more time trying to get another offer on the table, I might have bumped up my salary even more. But at that time, I just really needed to get my foot in the door, and I knew that once I had established my skill set and I had more projects to put on my portfolio, I would be able to get better offers later on down the road. So I'm of the belief that if you are early on in your career, like you're in your 20s, opportunities should weigh more than your compensation, because you can always make more money later down the road, but these growth opportunities where you can really establish your expertise and your skill set, those things don't come as often. So I took my first job even though I wasn't getting paid that much, because I knew that this was a rare opportunity for me to launch my UX design career. So if you are debating between two offers, one is giving you less money, but the projects are really cool, but the other one is offering you a better salary, but no one really knows about this product, they don't have really cool projects that you're passionate about, then I would definitely say take this offer over this one, because those opportunities won't come along regularly. So in summary, as an entry-level designer, you can expect your salary to be anywhere from 65K to 90K. Also note that new grads who have bachelor's in interaction design or human-computer interaction might get the higher end of the range because they do have a degree in design, whereas a bootcamp grad might be getting the lower end of the range. So in my first job, I left after 1.5 years of being there because I knew that I wasn't gonna get promoted, even though I was exceeding expectations for my role, because I saw all my male counterparts getting promoted and being recognized, but I was just working super hard but not being acknowledged or compensated for the hard work that I was putting in. So my second job, after 1.5 years of being a UX designer, I was making somewhere between 100 to 120K. And some people will say 100K is really low for an intermediate level designer, but I was also getting equity, and so my total comp was a lot more than just my base salary. And also the growth opportunity was just so big that I knew I needed to make the move. And then later down the road, I found out that some of my male counterparts who were hired at the same level as me with the same years of experience were getting paid a lot more than I was. So that was a bummer, but I'm glad I didn't find that out until much later when I was at that company, because if I had found out earlier, I would have been really hung up on how I wasn't making enough, and I would have started comparing myself, and it's this vicious cycle once you get into that comparison mode. And I actually focused a lot on how I can grow the most in that company. And I think my manager really saw that, because instead of me fighting for my own compensation and for a promotion, she fought for me because she saw how much I was putting into the company and the work that I was doing. And now it's been 3 years since I've been in UX design, and my compensation, my total compensation is over 200K, and this includes base salary, bonuses, equity, and benefits. And so coming from a marketing role and having transitioned into UX design after four years, I 5x'd my compensation, which is pretty phenomenal. Location also does matter. If you are a designer working from Seattle, New York, or Texas, anywhere that is not San Francisco or the Silicon Valley, you're probably gonna get paid less than if you would have worked in San Francisco, because these companies do consider cost of living when they are giving you your compensation package and the offers. And so there is a disparity there. A lot of you have asked me about negotiation tips. I will cover that in another video, but one thing I always tell people is always negotiate for something higher than what you are given, because even if you don't get anything out of it, you know that you tried. You know that you asked, and the words that they can say is no. The ball is still in your court. You're left to decide whether or not you want to take the offer. But if you don't ask, you're not going to get the practice of advocating for yourself and asking for more money. And that's something that you need to keep practicing, because practice makes perfect. And it is much harder for women to have these conversations, because you get self-conscious, you want to be liked by these recruiters and employers before you join. But men don't think about these things. So just ask, and if they say no, then there you go, you have your answer. Also, the best way to negotiate is if you have a competing offer. So if you really want to work for company A, but they're not paying you enough, but you got an offer for company B, but they're paying you higher, you can come back to company A and say, hey, they're giving me this much. Can you at least match the offer so that I can join you? Chances are that they will try to match you with that competing offer if they do have the budget for it. Sometimes they really don't have the budget for it, so they will say, no, sorry, we really can't give you what you want. And then the decision is yours. Before I end this video, I just want to remind you that you are worth so much more than what you produce, your productivity, what you make, how much money you bring. I know that capitalism and society have ingrained in our minds that we are what we produce, but you are worth so much more than that. But that doesn't mean salary isn't important, and it is important to have these conversations and to know what you actually deserve. And having a job that pays you really well has been really validating for me, because I know that my work is valuable, that this company is willing to pay me a lot of money for my work. It has also freed me up to pursue my passions without having to worry about finances. I'm also able to support organizations and causes that I deeply care about. With that said, 50% of the income that I make through affiliate links and through my YouTube videos will be going to organizations that I really care about that will help this nation become anti-racist. I hope you check out the links down below, and I will see you next time. Bye!